courteous reader. I might in this place attempt to gain the favor by declaring that I write almanacs with no other view than that of the public good. But in this, I should not be sincere. And men nowadays are too wise to be deceived by pretenses, how specious soever. The plain truth of the matter is, I am excessive poor, and my wife, good woman, is, I tell her, excessive proud. She cannot bear, she says, to sit spinning in her shift of tow, while I do nothing but gaze at the stars, and has threatened more than once to burn all my books and rattling traps, as she calls my instruments, if I do not make some profitable use of them for the good of my family. The printer has offered me some considerable share of the profits, and I have thus begun to comply with my dame's desire. Sloth, like rust, consumes faster than labor wears, while the use key is always bright. The sleeping fox catches no poultry. Drive the business. Let not the business drive you. Early to bed, early to rise, makes a man healthy, wealthy, and wise. There are no gains without pains. He that has a calling has an office of profit and honor. Diligence is the mother of good luck. One today is worth two tomorrows. Handle your tools without mitts. Remember, the cat in gloves catches no mice. Constant dropping wears away stones. Little strokes fell great oaks. Trouble springs from idleness. Three removes are as bad as a fire. Keep the shop, and the shop will keep you. Many a little makes a mickle. A small leak will sink a great ship. Buy what you have no need of, and soon you shall sell the necessaries. Silks and satins, scarlet and velvet, put out the kitchen fire. Always taking out of the meal tub and never putting in soon, comes to the bottom. It is hard for an empty sack to stand upright. Lazy folks take the most pains. God gives all things to industry. Plow deep while sluggards sleep, and you will have corn to sell and to keep. If you would have your business done, go. If not, send. Benjamin Franklin was the first American man of letters. Before him, with exception Cotton Mather's Magnalia, and perhaps the familiar letters of Mrs. John Adams, scarcely anything worthy of the name of literature existed in America. Franklin wrote much and wrote well. He lived with the pen in his hand. Some of his writings, notably the autobiography, The Way to Wealth, and the Edict of the King of Prussia are among the permanent monuments of our literature. Critics have always praised the clearness, power, and simplicity of his style. Sidney Smith merrily threatened to disinherit his daughter if she did not admire everything written by Franklin. His works and correspondence treat every subject, familiar and unfamiliar, in the 18th century. He wrote upon philosophy, politics, and economics. And he published many satires and brief essays which he called bagatelles. His contemporaries were impressed by his great wisdom and great simplicity. Francis Jeffrey said of his philosophical writings that they suggested the most ingenious and profound explanations, as if they were the most natural and obvious way of accounting for the phenomena. Franklin had little schooling. His knowledge was derived from wide and constant reading. He had from early childhood a passion for books, and he could not remember the time when he could not read. For 30 years he was actively engaged in journalism, and he mastered all the techniques of that profession. According to him, a good literary style should be smooth, clear, and short. The way in which he became the master of such a style he has told in the autobiography. Kant called him the Prometheus of modern times. Mirabeau rose in the National Assembly when the news of Franklin's death reached Paris to speak of him as the genius that freed America and poured a flood of light over Europe. The great Lord Chatham described him to the English Parliament as one whom all Europe pranks with our Boyles and Newtons, as an honor not to the English nation alone, but to human nature. When Voltaire and Franklin met in the hall of the French Academy, a cry arose that they should embrace each other, whereupon the crowd of scholars and statesmen and poets shouted, "Behold Solon and Sophocles embrace!"